CNN's coverage of the Gulf War continues. We want to take you now to Langley Air Force Base in Virginia and CNN's Tom Mintier. Tom?
We are at Langley Air Force Base where the F-15 pilots we've talked so much about today are based. And they have a support group here that has been working long before yesterday, long before this morning. This is a support group that started when they deployed in August, when they went into Saudi Arabia. Joining me now is Ida Simpkins. Ida, you didn't get many phone calls then last night after 7 o'clock. Nothing unexpected.
No, because we already had a system in place that our families would be notified in the event that there was conflict overseas. And we notified them and let them know that we would have a briefing this morning to inform them of the situation.
Has it helped? You know, we're talking about 1,300 flights, 1,300 sorties, and only one plane lost in that. Does that bring the anxiety level down for pilots on it?
Absolutely. They're very proud and they're very relieved.
What do you offer here for someone who, say, is having difficulty dealing with it?
We have support groups available to them. We always try to keep them informed through their units and through the support center. We try to just always keep them in touch with what's available on base and off base.
I was talking to one pilot's wife a little earlier, and she said they were getting together for a potluck dinner tonight. Is this something you encourage them to band together as a group?
Absolutely. And they are doing that today. They're together, and they always watch over each other and take care of each other.
Information is something that I hear people complain about, especially in dealing with the military, mm-hmm. because so much can't be said. Is the most important thing getting the information out to these family members as quickly as you can, and how do you do it?
Yes, it is very important because it does relieve their anxiety, and we do that through unit points of contact, and we have, as a result of the unit points of contact, they do notify the family members, and then we have base briefings to keep them informed.
Okay, Ida, thank you very much. As I was saying, they met here earlier this morning. They had a 10 o'clock briefing from the base commander. They met in the theater, and they all received the information that the Air Force sent out all at the same time, and then they went home. And as we found in visiting several homes, they went home and turned the television on to get even more information that is happening as each hour passed. I'm Tom Mintier, CNN, reporting live from Langley Air Force Base in Hampton, Virginia.
Thank you, Tom. Ralph?
And while we at CNN are dealing so much with so many pictures, John Zarrella of CNN is dealing primarily today with sounds. He's at a radio station in Sumter, South Carolina. John?
Ralph, we're at WDXY in Sumter, South Carolina, and Shaw Air Force Base is just a few miles down the road, and this is certainly a military town, a military city. There are F-16 fighters, two squadrons of them, about 48 planes, perhaps 500 or 600 people from this area who are deployed in the Persian Gulf, many of whom were very likely involved in the actions that have been taking place in the Persian Gulf. And here, the emotion throughout the afternoon and throughout the morning even has been just an outpouring of support for the troops that are over there. This is certainly a military town, a very patriotic bunch of people here. We'll let you listen in for just a minute to one of the callers.
Let me ask you something right now. You have a chance to send a message to Saddam Hussein. What is that message going to be today?
Are you allowed to put those things on the air?
If you can be as polite about it as you possibly can.
I probably can. I think that he should get out now while he's still got hair left on his head.
A head left on his body, okay.
or head left on his head. He's had, you know, plenty of time to make a decision to get out of Kuwait.
Well, what's the one thing that's bothering you most of all with this situation? There's got to be something that bothers you. What is it?
Those American protesters, the ones that burn the flag and say, you know, no oil for blood or blood for oil or whatever it is they say. I don't feel it's really about
the comments
oil.
That you're hearing right now is one that we've heard all day here today. One of the predominant things we've been hearing is a great sentiment against the protesters who have been burning the American flag. So the silent majority is certainly speaking out here in Sumter, South Carolina. This is John Zarrella reporting live from Sumter, South Carolina.
Thank you, John. Thank you very much, John. One very large concentration of anti-war protesters is coming from San Francisco. We heard earlier that as many as 1,000 protesters had surrounded the federal building. Let's check in now with CNN's Don Knapp. Don?
1,000 protesters or more had surrounded the federal building since about 6 o'clock this morning, where they did what they announced that they would intend to do, that is close down the federal building. What we think you're looking at now is the tail end of that massive demonstration that has just now moved away from the federal building and is heading into downtown San Francisco. While they were here, they managed to keep the federal building shut despite federal efforts to open it up and promise to escort in workers, but we saw no one escorted in this morning. It seemed that everybody was kept out of the building. The police did a couple of sweeps, managing to arrest about 300 people earlier today, and just about 50 minutes ago, they continued to make more sweeps on the other side of the building. The latest sweep coming just about 50 minutes ago. We suppose about 100 people were arrested then. Despite the arrest, the protesters hung on and hung on, continued to block physical traffic into the federal building. But the police apparently have prevailed because the protesters have given up. They've walked down the street and they're now going into downtown San Francisco. Where this is going, we're not quite sure. We know the crowd is very angry. We know this protest has been going on for some time and will likely continue to go on for some time. Reporting live in San Francisco, Don Knapp, CNN.
Thank you, Don. Let's go to Ralph now.
This has been an incredible day on Wall Street. And if you haven't heard what's been going on there, let's take you to the New York Stock Exchange and Jeanne Hopkins. Jeanne?
Thank you. Here on Wall Street, the rally continues as we go into the last half hour of trading. The rush to buy started at the open, the Dow moving up nearly 100 points. Prices broke through 100 about an hour ago. But now, the Dow is now up 105 and a half points at a level of 2614 and a third. Volume very, very heavy. 285 million shares changing hands. That's the heaviest since mid-October of 1989. Advancing issues ahead of declining issues by more than a 7-to-1 margin. The broader market is up very sharply. The S&P 500 up 10 and two-thirds points. Secondary market also up sharply. The over-the-counter markets, the Nasdaq Composite, up 9.5 points. Airline stocks, a sector of the market leading the charge today. Tumbling oil prices boosting most transportation stocks. An example, UAL, the parent of United, is up 7.625. A few losers in today's markets include oil stocks, most of them anyway. Chevron is down 0.875. Some traders are now talking about a glut in oil supplies. With high reserve levels and apparent Allied success, that feeling is pressuring futures in the U.S. benchmark crude to fall to pre-invasion prices. The crude oil prices are down $10.70 in New York, trading at $21.30 a barrel. Prices on refined products also sliding. Unleaded gasoline down 21 cents, selling at 61 cents a gallon on the futures market. Home heating oil down 29 cents, selling at 62 cents a gallon. In the credit markets, the long-term issues are rallying, short-term issues sink. The yield on the three-month Treasury bill up to 6.27%. Six-month bill at 6.5%. Treasury 30-year bond is up a sharp 2.5 points, and that yield is down to 8.17%. Investors are selling precious metals, optimistic that the conflict will be over quickly. With its safe haven status waning, gold is down $30.10, and silver down 19 cents. Prolonged war could boost the dollar with another flight to quality, but right now, reports of Allied success against Iraq has the U.S. currency falling sharply, down 4.75 yen against the Japanese currency, down 4 pfennigs against the German mark, and down 3 cents against the British pound. We'll keep you updated on this very hectic day in the financial market. Now, with the Dow Jones Industrial Average up 108 points, I'm Jeanne Hopkins reporting live from the New York Stock Exchange.
Thank you, Jeanne. As you may know, the eyes and ears of what's been going on in Baghdad, the CNN staff of reporters there were taken off the air by Iraqi officials earlier today, Bernard Shaw, John Holloman, and Peter Arnett. We are attempting to establish contact with them once more, and of course, as soon as we do that, we'll bring their reports to you. Sharyl?
Joining us now from London is Dilip Hiro. He is the author of more than a dozen books on the Middle East, including The Longest War, the Iran-Iraq Military Conflict. He is going to talk to us about Iraq's military capabilities. Thank you for joining us. You are a student of the Iran-Iraq War. Were there any lessons there that may foreshadow what we can expect to see in the fighting between Iraq and the Allied forces?
Yeah, I think the first thing is that the Iraqis are very good in defense. When they fought the Iranians and when the Iranians attacked their homeland, they were very tenacious and fought like hell to see that the Iranians did not occupy their country. Now, if they accept or if they have a feeling within themselves that Kuwait is part of Iraq, then I think they will fight as hard as if it is real Iraq.
Iraqi officials are putting out certain types of comments and responses today. Among them, Iraq is saying that the United States has exaggerated its air strength, that the United States planes, rather, are cowardly because they attack from high levels and bombarded down in which they could not be seen. How much does this war of words play a part in a war in which Iraq is involved?
I think any war, as you know, is a war with weapons and war with words. And I think the war with words started on the 2nd of August and is continuing. If we are looking at the military strategy, I think it's quite widely known that round one, which is started now, which is the air fight, Saddam Hussein is not going to use his interceptors or fighter aircraft to have dogfights with the Americans because he has no chance. His strategy is very simple. He has put his planes in the bunkers and he wants to save them. And we don't know how many have been destroyed, but one must remember he has at least 700 combat aircraft.
And would you presume at some point, if he is able to save a large number of his aircraft, that he would go on the offensive and come out of this defensive posture?
I think what happens is, you know, you have to go to round two. The round two is the ground war. And when the ground war takes place, or if it takes place, then of course it will be quite bloody. And it is at that point that Saddam Hussein would want to take out his aircraft and engage the Allies' aircraft in dogfights and so on. So he's actually saving this particular weapon for later on, when he will be playing with a strong card, and his strong card is 500,000 Iraqi soldiers dug into Kuwait with their tanks and so on.
One of the number one Allied goals was to try to destroy the chemical arsenal of Saddam Hussein. Do you think that could be effectively done in any way in a matter of a couple of days? Or is the chemical system that Saddam Hussein has set up to prevent that?
Well, I think, if it's any factory, they would have good air defenses, missiles, and so on. But the main thing, one has to make a distinction. One is manufacturing, assembling of chemical weapons. The other one is actually using them. Now, once you have chemical weapons assembled, they can be assembled in four different forms, as artillery shells, as rockets, as bombs, and as payload for ground-to-ground missiles. Now, even if the Americans have destroyed all his factories where he manufactures chemical and biological weapons, then he still has up to 100 tons of these gases stored and put into shells and rockets and bombs and so on. This is according to William Webster of the CIA. And these are scattered all over. That means all the frontline troops would have chemical shells for the artillery and so on. And because what happens if you go back to the experience of fighting the Iranians? When the Iranian offensive became very difficult to hold back, then the Iraqis used chemical weapons against the Iranians. And I think use of chemical weapons is the last resort, and if it comes to that, I think Saddam Hussein's troops will use that because it has proved effective and also they have experience of that. On top of that, we must remember there are 850 oil wells in Kuwait, and by all accounts, each of these wells has been put on explosives. Half of these wells are under pressure, and even if Saddam Hussein were not to blow them up for whatever reason, when big fight starts, all the rockets fall here and there, some of these wells would go up in flames, and that could create a lot of problems for both parties.
I want to get your opinion on the reports that we have heard of defections by Iraqi troops.
I think this is something which one has to take with some skepticism, because you remember last week there was a report like six helicopter pilots had defected, and that story was completely destroyed by the Saudi defense minister himself, and he said this is total fiction. So So I think that I would be inclined to believe this, you know, much more seriously when the ground fight has been joined and where there's a stalemate and, you know, some of the troops on the other side are getting fed up and they are getting frequent calls to the broadcast to come to them, then some of them may start defecting. But I think at this stage, I mean, I find it difficult. I'm not saying it has or has not happened because I have no way of finding this out. Nobody has any way of finding it out, but I would be skeptical. You know, this is the kind of a card which can only be played later on if it becomes necessary.
Thank you very much for sharing your insight with us. Dilip Hiro, author and freelance journalist, talking to us from London. Ralph?
There have been reports of several instances of what is believed to be terrorist activities from around the world. So far, no reports of any injuries or deaths. Especially watchful today are airports around the world. One of them is JFK Airport, Kennedy Airport in New York. And let's go to CNN's Jim Hill now for an update on what's going on there. Jim?
Well, Ralph, I'm here with members of the U.S. men's ski team. Some very disappointed skiers, to say the least, but nonetheless very happy to be home safe and sound. These are among 40 men and 25 women who had to pull out of the biggest competition of the year, the downhill World Cup race in Bingen, Switzerland, and they pulled out because of worries over possible terrorist attacks. Now, the decision was made late last night by the coach, who is Bill Egan. Bill, why'd you make that decision?
Well, it was a joint decision made by myself and a number of people that are in the office in Park City, Utah. And we just decided that it wasn't worth risking the lives of so many young people that we're ultimately responsible for. So we decided to pull out of the World Cup competition, even though we were disappointed to have to do that sort of thing. But it's more important that our kids are safe and home.
Did you really feel that a high-profile group like that would be a target?
Well, there's always that possibility, and it's not worth risking at this point.
All right. Now, that competition would have taken place tomorrow. The World Cup is really the biggest competition of the year. It's what these people train for. This is one of the skiers, Eric Keck. Must be disappointing.
Yeah, it's a little disappointing. Recently, the U.S. skiing, U.S. skiing as a whole really started to come on strong, and it's unfortunate that we had to leave, but it seems pretty insignificant, compared to a war going on. I'm just glad to be home safe, and, everybody's really feels the same way about it, we had to do it, I think.
Okay, there you have some very disappointed skiers, but of course they are home safe and sound, and obviously we'll ski again. I'm Jim Hill reporting live for CNN from Kennedy Airport, New York.
To a great extent, senators, congressmen, representatives have been rallying behind President Bush and the action that he has taken so far in this war. Let's get an update from Capitol Hill and CNN's Bob Franken. Bob?
Sharyl, just in case you're beginning to lose faith in the ability of Congress to engage in partisan debate, your faith is about to be restored. Even as they're trying to come up with a resolution in support of the war effort, there is a behind-the-scenes debate between Republicans and Democrats exactly what form that resolution should take. Republicans have come up with one that says a resolution supporting the president and the troops in the Persian Gulf. Meanwhile, the Democrats' version of that would be supporting the troops in the Persian Gulf, absent, of course, any reference to the president in the title. That is being fought over behind closed doors now. It is hoped that they'll be able to settle their differences and hopefully pass some sort of resolution of support tomorrow. Again, I didn't want you to lose faith in the ability of Congress to get partisan. Meanwhile, on the serious side of things, there are a number of briefings going on up here today. The defense secretary is expected to brief the Senate in just a short while, and then the House of Representatives a little while after that. Congressional leaders say the president has assured them that he will continue to give them briefings during the duration of the fight against Iraq. For the most part, however, the congressional role is as a Greek chorus, offering its impressions in the background. But Congress soon will have a role.
We will, of course, be receiving requests from the administration for funding necessary to support the operations there. Obviously, a very essential function under our Constitution. And we will also stand ready to receive any other messages or requests from the executive branch regarding the conduct of operations.
We are united in our support of our men and women in the Persian Gulf and in our prayers for their safety.
Today I have two prayers. One for the safety of all our brave servicemen and women in the Gulf, and another that Saddam Hussein will finally see the light.
The time for political discussion and Monday morning quarterback will come later. Today, let us become a family.
Mr. Speaker, I remain opposed to the political decision by the President to mobilize those troops for war. I came to this position as a matter of conscience. I cannot turn off my conscience for political expediency.
Congressman Dellums at this particular point is one of the few dissenting voices. For the most part, there is a Rally Around America theme up in Congress, but political expediency is something that does enter into the debate every once in a while, and perhaps as the war drags on, if it does, there may be more people coming out against, but for the moment, the President is enjoying strong support on Capitol Hill. Bob Franken, CNN Live, Capitol Hill.
Bob, Congress's authorization of the use of force for the president was different than a technical declaration of war, and I have heard some people asking the question, at what point or will Congress meet again and try to get through a declaration of war? Have you heard any talk about that?
Well, congressional leaders want to avoid that entirely. They are making the argument that effectively what they did last week was a declaration of war. They admit that it's officially not a declaration of war, but they believe that they have fulfilled all the legal requirements, and they want to avoid that fight. So there will be this declaration of war without a declaration of war.
Interesting that Congress was split over the resolution authorizing the use of force, and yet Congress seems to come together in times like this once a decision is made. What do you think there is about that?
Well, the members of Congress are making it clear that they don't want Saddam Hussein to believe that this is a split country. They believe that in the United States the message is that there can be debate, but that the United States can unify in a time of crisis, like they believe that they're unifying now behind the president, behind the troops at least, in the battle with Saddam Hussein.
Thank you. Bob Franken reporting to us from Capitol Hill. Ralph?
You know, Britain makes up the second largest military contingent against Iraq. A lot of officials in Britain have been expressing their views throughout the day about how they think the operation has been going. Let's go to Mitch Leopard now in London for an update. Mitch?
Well, Ralph, it's been a day of reaction here. British ships and aircraft took part in the pre-dawn assault on Iraq. And this afternoon, there were reports that some of the approximate 35,000 British ground troops in Saudi Arabia were moving closer to the Kuwaiti border, perhaps preparing for a ground assault on Iraqi defenses. Most of the people we talked to today in London expressed relief that Operation Desert Storm went so smoothly, a feeling echoed in this newspaper headline throughout London today. British readers, however, cautioned against jubilation. Defense Minister Tom King told reporters one British plane had been lost, and Prime Minister John Major told Parliament a fierce battle may lie ahead.
I must say to my honourable friend that we should be under no illusions whatsoever about the scale and potential might of the Iraqi forces. Whilst I am confident about the success, I cannot yet be confident about the speed of that success, and I think we should prepare ourselves for that fact.
The initial impression indicates that the combined air operations have inflicted significant damage on the targets concerned. In the initial sorties, all our aircraft have returned safely. But I have to advise you that during a later sortie, one Tornado suffered an engine fire, and it and its crew are missing.
Defense Ministry spokesman would not confirm reports broadcast by the BBC that the missing crew had bailed out over Iraqi territory and that a search operation was underway. A little over an hour ago, I spoke with a woman who was prime minister of this country when the Gulf crisis began and who played such a crucial role in determining how Britain would respond.
Well, first, I would like to say thank you to President Bush and the American people for the tremendous leadership they've shown ever since Saddam Hussein started this war on August the 2nd, and the way in which they've got and kept all the allies together, and we're still together. I felt when the action started, and for us it was nearly midnight last night as we turned on the television sets and saw what was happening, that we were indicating that the period of uncertainty when we could possibly hope for Saddam Hussein to withdraw was over. He'd had so many chances to withdraw. It was quite clear that he was taking what I call a typical dictator's stance. Dictators don't withdraw. They have to be defeated. The first day's action went very well, and I think we're all very pleased. That is only the beginning. Each day has to be planned just as carefully, just as meticulously, carried out with just that attention to detail that happened on the first day. No, I don't believe in pauses, unless they're necessary from your own military viewpoint. I think a pause may very well help your enemy, and it's our purpose to get this job done and completed, and Kuwait free once again.
And of course, that was the former Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher. The current Prime Minister, John Major, spoke with the Queen this afternoon after what they call question time in Parliament. And in a few minutes, he will be addressing the United Kingdom. Mitch Leppard, CNN Live in London. Back to you, Ralph.
Mitch, down through the years, for many reasons, Britain has been the recipient of various terrorist activities. Is there any worry or concern now that the anger over this attack is going to spill over into Britain?
Well, the British have long been prepared for terrorism attacks in this country because of its long experience with the Irish Republican Army. Counterterrorism is just another word for another department in the police department here. And we have done reports in recent days at Heathrow Airport and all around town about increased security. As far as airline terrorism, which we've heard much about in recent days and has been prompted and discussed by terrorists in the Middle East, the British authorities say simply they have been prepared ever since Lockerbie for the event of that. And ever since the latest threats out of Iraq, they've increased their attention to security just that ever so little bit more.
Mitch, what about the people on the street? What do you hear from there? Are they in agreement with the government officials over how successful this has been and how Britain should be a part of this?
Well, if you attended some of the demonstrations that are taking part throughout the city this evening, you would say no. But we know, after watching 3 or 4 hours of Parliament this afternoon, that from a government point of view, that most are wholeheartedly in support of the government's actions here. I think the people, like in a lot of places, are probably split down the middle, but at this moment the country is engaged in a war with Saddam Hussein, and I think if push comes to shove, they're going to say they support the government.
All right, thank you very much. Mitch Leppard is in London. Sharyl.
Jordan is a nation that is geographically and perhaps psychologically caught in the middle of this war and sees itself as one of the big potential victims. CNN's Doug James wraps up the day in Amman, Jordan.
The blood-red sunrise was like an omen over the Middle East.
It is a war between the devil and God.
But even the most faithful could be forgiven for believing God had somehow slept through the human thunder that descended from the heavens over Baghdad. War knows no boundaries, and here in Amman, Jordan, 650 miles to the southwest, the pain of destruction was felt as surely as it was felt in the heart of Baghdad. For here, Palestinians believe the attack on Saddam Hussein's Iraq also killed their lifelong dream of a homeland.
Iraq gave them hope. That hope could be misguided, could be forced, could be exaggerated, but it gave them that hope, and they see the American administration and their allies trying and working very hard to destroy their hope.
The people of Jordan woke up to the news with shock and dismay.
We were very sorry and very angry in the house when we heard the news.
Shock and dismay that followed them through the entire day as more news came from Baghdad. Even some Kuwaitis in exile were saddened that it had come to this.
And we feel sorry. We feel sorry for the whole story, since August the 2nd until now.
King Hussein of Jordan called an emergency meeting of his cabinet, and afterward a government spokesman condemned what he called the brutal assault on an Arab neighbor. Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev sent an urgent letter appealing to Jordan, caught in the middle between Iraq and Israel, to stay out of the conflict. And in a CNN interview, Crown Prince Hassan said his nation would do its best to help those caught in the middle of war.
It will. This is a question of people. Where people matter. All people matter, of course.
The pre-war escape from Iraq suddenly became a post-war exodus as dozens of families fled the war-torn nation. One bus dodged bombs throughout the night as it made its way to the Jordanian border.
Jordan, which only last week closed its border with Iraq to most refugees, has now had a change of heart. The United Nations Relief Organization says it will pay all costs involved. And as a result, the government here says it will lift its restrictions. It says it can handle up to 50,000 refugees, but it expects more than 750,000. Doug James, CNN, Amman.
And there is a lot more to come in our coverage of the war in the Gulf. For Sharyl Atkinson, I'm Ralph Wenge. Stay with us.
Welcome back, buddy. Good job, guys. All right. Welcome back. Give me time, you.
Good show.
It is just after midnight now in the Persian Gulf. Day two of Operation Desert Storm gets underway. Allied naval forces now appear to be gearing up for an amphibious assault on Kuwait.
Both U.S. and Iraqi leaders claim to have God on their sides. President Bush and many of his cabinet members attend a church service.
And Iraqi television shows Saddam Hussein at prayer. Hello, I'm Sharyl Atkinson at CNN Center in Atlanta.
And I'm Ralph Winger. We still haven't been able to communicate with our people in Baghdad. The Iraqi government disrupted the line just about 5 hours ago. We, of course, will keep you informed. But in other developments, we can tell you this. The U.S. and allied forces are launching a third wave of almost unanswered bombing raids against Iraq and occupied Kuwait at this hour. The allied forces reportedly have flown more than 1,300 sorties against Iraq and occupied Kuwait ever since the start of the war. But so far, reports only three planes lost in the battle. Baghdad Radio claims Iraqi forces have shot down 44 attacking allied warplanes. With more developments in the Gulf, CNN's Al Hinman files this report.
On Iraqi television, pictures of Saddam Hussein with his troops, along with a vow to fight on. No longer on television around the world, live reporting from Baghdad. Iraqi censors pulled the plug on CNN's three correspondents, last live link to the outside world. Shortly afterwards, Iraqi TV was reported off the air, but Iraqi radio continued broadcasting. In the Persian Gulf, preparations appeared to be underway for an amphibious assault on Kuwait. Allied forces poised, waiting for word to join the action. Along the Kuwaiti-Saudi border, a Saudi oil facility burned following one of the few Iraqi attacks. Operation Desert Storm is so far an aerial war. There have been more than 1,000 Allied air sorties. Not making it back to base, three warplanes, one each from the United States, the United Kingdom, and Kuwait. Allied commanders were pleased with their early successes, but agreed the war is far from won.
We've been instructed to execute the plan, to carry on these operations until we have achieved our objective. Our objective is to get Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait.
That's yet to happen, according to a Kuwaiti eyewitness.
The city is calm. There's sometimes every once in a while there's intermittent machine guns in the streets, There's some confrontation between the Kuwaiti underground and the Iraqi army, but on a very small scale in some areas of the city itself.
Around the world, fears of possible Iraqi terrorist bombings prompting an ever higher level of security. From Kuwait's U.S. ambassador, a thank you to the Allies.
We hope this will conclude swiftly and decisively.
Al Hinman, CNN, reporting.
As we told you a moment ago, about 5 hours ago, CNN's crews and correspondents in Baghdad were taken to the bomb shelter of their hotel, the Al-Rashid Hotel, by Iraqi officials. We are still trying to reestablish contact with them so that we can get more reports out for you. In the meantime, let's go live to the White House and CNN's Charles Bierbauer. Charles.
Sharyl, this has been a day of appraisals and prayers for President Bush, a series of meetings and briefings, two of them in the cabinet room with leaders of Congress and members of the president's cabinet. President Bush is taking a careful but very favorable view of the way things are going. He is certainly pleased with the early results. At the start of that cabinet meeting, the president was asked if the only way out for Saddam Hussein is unconditional surrender.
Not going to stop until he fully complies with the resolution. So let's not worry about what we call it. Let's worry about we want to make it clear, full compliance with the UN resolution full compliance with the objectives of the coalition forces. I think all of us are very pleased that so far the operation is going forward with great success, and we keep praying that the loss of life will be held at an absolute minimum. And I feel so strongly about our troops over there. Certainly I feel that way about them, and I feel that way about the innocents who might get caught up in this conflict.
President Bush and many of his key advisors also attended a church service today at nearby Fort Myer. That's an Army installation just outside of Washington. At that particular service, Billy Graham, the evangelist who had spent the night at the White House as the president's guest, lamented that at this late date in the 20th century, the world is still unable to solve its problems peacefully. Charles Bierbauer, CNN, live at the White House.
Charles, as we hear reports of what has happened so far in this war out of the White House and the Pentagon, I get the sense that it is tough to walk a line between measured optimism and the danger of overconfidence, the president wanting to say that he's happy with the operation so far, but not wanting to be too happy or too pleased because it's so early on.
From a military standpoint, there's no question that the bombing operations have been extremely successful. But what you hear is that we are now in day two of this operation. We've been told by officials here and over at the Pentagon that it has a considerable way to go. No one can say precisely, and we have only dealt with an air war at this point, and a one-sided one. If there is a ground war ahead, that could be extremely complicated and extremely costly, hence the extreme caution.
The resolutions that Congress passed authorizing the use of force required the president to give certain notification to certain members of Congress before the action was taken. The president did complete those notifications, it was reported. We had heard President Reagan say in the past that the Capitol leaks like a sieve and that there was a danger in telling anybody what one was planning to do, and yet this seemed to be kept a total secret. Was that a surprise, do you think?
I'm not sure that one should look upon that as a surprise. What the president did was in the hour or two before the launching of this attack, he called the congressional leadership, the Speaker of the House, the Majority Leader in the Senate, the President pro tem, and advised them of what was going on. These are very careful, very responsible individuals. They had indeed, after all the debate was done on Capitol Hill, said this is the will of the Senate. The President has the authority to do as has been decided here. Speaker Foley, Senator Mitchell, who were both at the White House today, fully endorsed what the president is doing. I don't think there was a problem of leaks in any way, shape, or form by informing those gentlemen. Certainly not.
Thank you. Charles Bierbauer reporting to us from the White House. Ralph?
At the United Nations at this hour, we're hearing reports that there could be several countries who are in favor of reconvening the Security Council. To get the latest on that, let's go to the United Nations now and CNN's Jeanne Moos. Jeanne?
Well, there are wire service reports, and I think some of the reports are based on the Algerian news agency, saying that several countries have called on the Security Council to order an immediate halt to the U.S.-led war. These countries would be Algeria, Libya, and Yemen. Now, we don't attach a lot of significance to this yet, because even if these countries do call on the Council to order an immediate halt, it is simply a totally far-fetched, out-of-the-question idea. The UN Security Council is, this is just an idea that has no support in the Security Council. And even if it did have support in the Security Council, the U.S. has veto power, the Soviet Union has veto power, Britain has veto power. It would simply be killed if there is any sort of move in this direction. And just a few minutes ago, I got off the phone with the Cuban ambassador to the UN, and Cuba is one of the two countries that voted against the use of force resolution in the Security Council. And I said to the Cuban ambassador, what are your options? He said, the options are very few. There just isn't much that can be done for those countries that want to try to stop this U.S.-led action. So right now, there are no plans for the Council to meet yet. I absolutely wouldn't rule out a possible meeting to talk about it, but as for there actually being action from the Security Council, I simply, it seems out of the question.
So, Jeanne, there's no sense there that people are running around trying to look for any way possible, perhaps, to find some kind of a peace initiative?
And it's pretty close to the...
There really isn't at this point, because everyone is saying, and the Secretary General repeated it again today, that the only way for this to end is for Iraq to get out of Kuwait. Everyone is saying that. And given the situation with the veto power in the Security Council, the U.S. can enforce its wishes, along with Britain and the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union even has been very strong with its public support for the U.S. action. And so I really don't see any peace initiatives coming out of here at this point.
All right. Thank you. We'll keep in touch. Jeanne Moos at the United Nations. Sharyl?
We have an update now from the State Department and CNN's Ralph Begleiter. Ralph?
Sharyl, the U.S. is offering no public indication of how the Iraqis might bring about an end to the attacks. There is no communication, direct or indirect, with the Iraqi government right now. And officials say here there is no indication that Iraq even wants to talk to the U.S. In fact, now that the fighting has begun, the talking appears to have stopped.
The game has changed, and he must, one way or the other, leave Kuwait. And one way or the other, the 12 United Nations resolutions are going to be honored.
Officials here agree the United States may not be the first to hear from the Iraqis. Some officials expect Iraq to get in touch first with some Arab intermediary, or perhaps a former ally, such as France or the Soviet Union, rather than the United States. Secretary of State James Baker has been staying closely in touch with President Bush today, and reportedly has had no contact even with other members of the international coalition against Iraq. Since the attacks began, there have been a number of incidents at American diplomatic outposts around the world, the Molotov cocktails in Milan, and a few broken windows at the embassy in Islamabad. To prevent such incidents here in Washington, security here at the State Department is unusually tight. Entrances have been chained, access routes closed off, but there has been no indication of any threat here. And despite the fighting in the Gulf, U.S. officials say there's been no sign of any credible terrorist threat. Ralph Begleiter, CNN, reporting live from the State Department.
You raise an interesting point, Ralph. We asked that to Frank Sesno at the White House last hour. How would President Hussein get in touch with President Bush if need be? Perhaps the biggest signal that the President Bush could be looking for would be actual troop movement rather than a telephone call or personal contact.
I think the United States is looking for troop movements, a withdrawal from Kuwait. But if there were some diplomatic exchange to be conducted, I think it would be unlikely that President Hussein would try to get in touch with President Bush. Although the Iraqis have tried to make this look like an Iraqi-American conflict, it wouldn't surprise me if Iraq tries to go through someone else, such as Algeria, Tunisia, the Jordanians perhaps, all of whom have good contacts with the United States. But it would prevent, it would enable Saddam Hussein to conduct whatever negotiations he might want to conduct without having to fall on his knees to the United States.
Thank you. Ralph Begleiter reporting to us from the State Department. Ralph?
So far, of course, this has been an air war. And, of course, the Marines in the desert continue to wait. They are anxious to find out what happens in the next phase of Operation Desert Storm. Right now, let's pause for a moment. Listen to some of the sights and sounds of these Marines.
The Iraq War was nothing but maybe a limited amount of support, some airlift, reconnaissance. But Ross,
wasn't
really an air war.
We had heard prior to the beginning of Operation Desert Storm, that probably the cruise missiles would be used first.
Well, I think there's a great deal of relief that we're doing what we came here to do and that we're on our way.
Anything that speed this up to get us home sooner is fine with me.
And you're happy we've gone to war?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm not glad about the aspect about going to war, and I don't think any Marine sitting here in this desert is, but something's happening, and it's the start. It's the start of something.
Thinking about it, and you could hear the rumbles last night when it was real quiet. Like, wow, okay, it started. And then you start thinking about now what's going
to
happen.
Remember you as a man that comes to me and says that.
That's what I'm worried about. What happens next?
It's just beginning. As it is a very big military, fourth largest in the world. It's not like people think, you know, it's come easy. It's not going to be an easy walk like Panama or Grenada. One of these go in and come out very quickly. We believe the United States is going to suffer some casualties.
Let me just insert something here. As we continue to watch.
2 days ago, many of the military camps in the desert were swamped with mud after 36 hours of heavy rain. Now conditions are close to ideal. On the main highway leading north to the Kuwaiti border, there are still long convoys of heavy military equipment, almost all of it American, heading for the front.
Marines in the desert. Admiral Robert Dunn was Chief of Naval Operations for Air Warfare and a senior advisor to the U.S. Naval Institute. Admiral Dunn joins us now from our bureau in Washington for a conversation of what's been going on in the Gulf. I have to begin by asking you, Admiral, your thoughts on President Bush's decision to act as he did.
Well, I certainly support the president four square. He did what he had to do, and he did it in a timely fashion, and he allowed the armed forces to execute the best plan available to them.
As Chief of Naval Operations for Air Warfare, you are obviously thinking very, very much about the way our pilots performed.
Well, that's absolutely right, and the pilots evidently performed superbly. We don't have all of the evidence back from what they actually accomplished. That awaits release, I guess, by the Defense Department. But the fact that all but three of them came back to their bases shows that they did a good job. They did the job the way they were trained to do it.
Did the fact that the attack, by some people's accounts anyway, that it came so quickly after the deadline, did that surprise you?
No, not really. I think that once the deadline passed, we had to do something, and the troops were ready, they were at their peak, and it was time to send them into the game.
What about the lack of response by Iraq? Were you surprised by that?
No, Iraq does not have a reputation of having a capability to fight at night. They were surprised. We took advantage of our NATO capabilities in the Air Force and with the Navy aviators and the Marine aviators there. And so I wasn't at all surprised that they were surprised and did not respond.
So if this had been a day attack, the result could have been entirely different. Is that what you're saying?
I don't think it would have been entirely different. There may have been some difference. For example, they could have perhaps done better with their anti-aircraft. They could have done better with their surface-to-air missiles. They might have even gotten some of their aircraft airborne. But by attacking at night, we were able to suppress that before they were able to react.
All right, we have seen and heard what happened on night one. We are now in night two. What do you expect to happen?
I think it'll be more of the same. We'll have to go back and revisit some of the targets that weren't completely neutralized during the first night and during the day today. I think we may see some attacks from heavier aircraft, some B-52 attacks, perhaps further into the country, just kind of cleaning up on things they didn't get the first couple of days.
Do you expect this to continue to be an air assault?
I think that the air war will last for another 2 to 4 days in order to ensure that we've gained air dominance. And then after that, if the operational commanders deem it necessary, the president deems it necessary, the ground war will commence.
What do you think is going to happen then if the ground forces have to go in?
Well, I don't have any access to the plans. I think that there will be an assault at some place of Iraqi weakness, perhaps in several directions, and go ahead and try to trap some of the Iraqi troops and talk them into surrendering, giving up their arms, and reducing loss of life that way.
What about Saddam Hussein himself? Any chance of him giving up?
That's a question for a psychologist, I guess. I don't think there's any real chance of him giving up until we go in and take some of his territory and neutralize most of his ground forces.
There is still a threat of a warning, actually, to Israel. Is that a realistic threat?
Well, we seem to have neutralized all of the fixed cruise missiles, ballistic missiles that Iraq has. There may be a few mobile scuds around, and that's one of the jobs of the Air Forces during the next period of time, to ensure that those missiles are neutralized. That's really, I think, the only threat to Israel. An air attack is unlikely. The Israeli Air Force would get to the attacking Iraqi aircraft before they could get started. The other possibility, of course, is terrorist attacks, and that's a different subject.
All right. Admiral Robert Dunn, thank you, sir, for being with us.
Thank you.
We'll be back with more right after this. As you know, there have been quite a few protests across the country against the war effort, and in Los Angeles, there are a group of high school students who are taking things into their own hands in a, well, maybe not an unusual way, but they hope perhaps an effective way. Dan Blackburn is in Los Angeles now. He brings us up to date. Dan?
Ralph, this may be the largest demonstration in the city of Los Angeles today opposing the war in the Middle East. And the interesting thing about this particular demonstration is that it has been organized and completely made up of junior high school students. It was put together by a 15-year-old student here at Burroughs Junior High on the outskirts of Hollywood. And obviously, from what you can see, it has been remarkably successful. That is not to say that every student in this junior high school is opposed to the war. Opinions clearly are divided. But the sentiment against the war is large and vocal. Among those taking part has been Amanda Lewis. Amanda, you helped organize this. How would you describe the sentiment among your fellow students?
Well, you know, we have divided and we have with us some peaceful protests. Right now, you know, it's hard when you have students running things, but I think it's going pretty well. It was hard organizing, but, you know, to get our point across, we did use our voices loudly, and what we wanted to stress is it's a peaceful demonstration. It's not something that, you know, you get out of class for. It's something that was peaceful. We're here for peace, and we're in for peace. And
you kids are 13, 14, 15. Are the people in this school actually taking this seriously?
We have some who are taking it seriously. I mean, you know, there's some who are not going to know how they feel because, yeah, they're at an age where they're immature, and they don't really know, you know, what's going on. But that's why we're here. We're here to educate. We're here to teach, you know, what's going on. Try to, you know, explain to them what's going on and, you know, and how it should be and how it shouldn't be. What we right now we need to do is we all need to come together and teach. You know, we're all young, yes, and that's why we're here. It's because it's our future. It's what they're dealing with right now. And that's why we need to have a loud voice about peace.
All right. Thank you very much for talking with us. This demonstration will continue for a short while, and then the students will all go back to class, where it's likely that what is going on in the Middle East will continue to be a subject of discussion and debate. Dan Blackburn, CNN Live in Hollywood.
We're going from Hollywood now to Capitol Hill, where CNN's Bob Franken has been measuring congressional opinion to what's been happening the past 2 days. Apparently, Congress is together on wanting to praise or show their support for President Bush, but not on exactly how to do it. Bob?
Actually, Sharyl, the difference is whether or not to show support for President Bush, at least in the official wording of the resolution of support. Everybody is together in wanting to show support for the American fighting men and women in the Persian Gulf. But it has become a political dispute over whether that same resolution should express support for the president. The Democrats are saying that would just cause unnecessary political debate. The Republicans are saying that you cannot have support for the troops without having support for the commander-in-chief.
What will be the business of Congress over the next couple of days, Bob?
Well, actually, Congress doesn't really have much of a role here. It's really now in the hands of the executive branch. And most of the people in Congress really just want to, in effect, stay in the background. I'm reminded of the Hippocratic Oath, the first words of which are, first, do no harm. And I think that that's really sort of the view up in Congress. They don't want to do anything that would harm the American effort against Iraq at this time. At least they don't want to do anything that would be perceived as doing harm to it.
As you've been mingling, as I assume you must have been, with some of the senators and representatives today, what are the kinds of things you've been hearing them say?
Well, most of them are wondering what's going to happen. Most of them are hoping that this is a short war. Most of them know, or say they know, that if the war is protracted, if there are more and more casualties, it's going to become a more divided nation, and there's quite a bit of consciousness, as you're probably aware, Sharyl, over the possibility that we would sink into the kind of morass in the United States that had gripped the country during the Vietnam era.
Tell us about partisan politics, the role they may play in the near future. Right now, Congress is showing support for the action that President Bush has taken, if not for President Bush himself. But we know that in the back of their minds, some of the Democrats have hoped they could get some sort of advantage with the American public, their party, in the upcoming presidential election. At what point do you expect to see some of this actually come into play?
Well, if you look real closely, you can see some now. It's not a matter at this point of trying to get an advantage. It's really probably more a point, Sharyl, of trying not to be stuck with a disadvantage. Right now, there are a combination of things. One, there is a genuine patriotism, as you can imagine, among most members of Congress. But at the same time, everybody wants to make sure that he or she comes out politically as far ahead as he or she can, or at least politically not too far behind.
Thank you very much. Bob Franken reporting to us from Capitol Hill. We'll be back with more news right after this.
Once again, we want to bring you up to date on our staff in Baghdad. Bernard Shaw, John Holland, and Peter Arnett were all taken off the air today by Iraqi officials. We are attempting now to reestablish contact with them, and hopefully, before long, they will be able to get back and do more of what they did so well. Report. Naval and ground forces are getting ready to join U.S. and allied warplanes in the massive assault on Iraq. U.S. officials say it is too late now for Iraq to pull out of Kuwait. It must now surrender or face war 24 hours a day. Now, shown here are allied naval vessels carrying military equipment that can be used in amphibious assaults on the Kuwaiti coast. A WTN camera crew flying over the Persian Gulf took these aerial views. U.S. Marines like these and a powerful allied army are on the move along Saudi Arabia's border with Kuwait. Meanwhile, the aerial pounding of Iraq continues. The Iraqis claim 44 allied planes destroyed, but the United Nations coalition admits only 3 planes lost, one each from the United States, Britain, and Kuwait. The Iraqis also claim to have downed 33 missiles like these Tomahawks in the battleship USS Wisconsin. Iraq says missiles and bombs have killed 23 civilians and wounded 33, but give no figure on military casualties. President Bush briefed congressional leaders on the war in the Gulf. The president said Operation Desert Storm is going forward with great success and added that he hopes that loss of life can be kept to a minimum. Iraqi television showed pictures of Saddam Hussein walking among the cheering crowds of Baghdad, but it isn't certain whether these pictures were taken before or after the bombing raid. The Iraqi leader, still defiant, said President Bush is deluding himself if he thinks the Iraqi ground army can be neutralized. Iraq ordered CNN's Baghdad staff, as we said earlier, off the air. We still are attempting to reestablish communication with them.
An interesting day has closed on Wall Street. It has been up to Jeanne Hopkins to measure how the actions in the Gulf are reacting on Wall Street. She has an update from the New York Stock Exchange. Jeanne?
Thank you. Here on Wall Street, it was up from the open as investors jumped in from the sidelines to buy. The Dow moved straight up 100 points as traders and investors acted as if the war was already over and peace has come. At the closing bell, the Dow up 114.60. We'll start tomorrow at 26.23.5. That is the second biggest gain ever for the Dow. Volume was the heaviest since October of 1989, with 319 million shares changing hands. And advancing issues were 7-1 over declining issues. Broader market also much higher. New York Stock Exchange Composite Index up almost 6 points. The S&P 500 Index up almost 12 points. The American Stock Exchange Index up 3.83. The over-the-counter market, the NASDAQ Composite, up 10 2/3 points. Oil prices nosediving today. The U.S. benchmark crude fell $7.50 at the open. That plunge resulted in a one-hour trading halt at the New York Mercantile Exchange. When trading resumed, crude continued to slide. The close down $10.56 at $21.44 a barrel. That is the biggest one-day move ever in crude prices in New York. It's the lowest level since Iraq invaded Kuwait. Gold and silver also tailspinning today. Investors betting on a short war in the Gulf. Gold down $30.10 an ounce to $374.40 an ounce. And silver down 19 cents to $4.04 an ounce. In the credit markets, bond prices posting their biggest gains in nearly 3 years. Tumbling oil prices helped push the Treasury's 30-year bellwether issue up 2 10/32nds. And the yield all the way down to 8.19%. In New York currency trading, the dollar fell sharply as its role as a safe haven diminished. The greenback closing off 4 2/3 yen against the Japanese currency, down 4 pfennigs against the German mark, and down 2 3/4 cents against the British pound. Recapping, the Dow finishing with the second biggest one-day gain in its history, up 114 2/3 points. I'm Jeanne Hopkins, reporting live from the New York Stock Exchange.
Thank you, Jeanne. U.S. and allied warplanes have been hammering Iraqi forces all day now. Some of the pilots flying the sorties are from the 35th Tactical Fighter Wing based at George Air Force Base in California. They've been coming and going all day from an air base in the Gulf. They've been rearming and they've been remanning their F-4 fighters with fresh crews. Jim Hickey is a U.S. military pool correspondent, and he files this report.
It is a non-stop, round-the-clock operation.
All day long, Air Force and Marine jet fighters took off from this Persian Gulf airbase heading for Iraq. They were bristling with bombs and missiles, TARMs, Pharaohs, Sidewinders. One by one, the warplanes returned, their bomb racks empty. But not for long. Immediately, ground crews rearmed the powerful jets. Fresh and rested pilots and crews got ready to take off again. Some of them making sure their bullets have Saddam Hussein's name on them. The flight crews had been briefed thoroughly, had been told what to expect, especially in the way of anti-aircraft fire. Still, this is the first time most have seen combat, and they were not fully prepared for what they saw.
You always hear about what you see on the ground. People talk to you about what they saw in Vietnam. But when you first see it, it's impressive.
It was something I've never experienced before. I've felt I was pretty well trained for it, but until you actually see all the AAA, the lights coming up, the tracers, it's kind of a different experience.
Pilots said they escaped the anti-aircraft fire by staying above it. American military commanders are concerned that Saddam Hussein apparently hasn't attempted any serious retaliation yet. That's why they say the next 12 hours, as we approach the second night of Operation Desert Storm, could be critical. The base will be on full alert for Iraqi Scud missiles.
We have not seen the reactions yet that we had anticipated. Of course, the part of the war plan was to eliminate those Scud missiles as soon as possible.
Meanwhile, the bombing runs continue, and they will, said one pilot, until Hussein rolls over and plays dead. This is Jim Hickey with the television pool in the Persian Gulf.
We're going to let you hear an excerpt of an interview with the commander of the Saudi Arabian Armed Forces talking about those reports of possible Iraqi defections. Here is that tape.
General, there have been unconfirmed reports of thousands of what you would call military refugees, we would call defectors. Can you tell us about that?
No, we don't have any people or soldiers surrenders until now, for the last 24 hours. We are hoping that they will come to their senses and save the bloodshed. There is a lot of rumors. There is also rumors about the 50 tanks coming in front of us to and surrendering. That is also not true yet. So until now, I would like to give the facts that, you know, until now I have no comments on that thing because it's not confirmed, and for the 50 tanks, it's not true yet.
You just made a statement that you have had no defectors whatsoever?
In the last 24 hours. But before that, yes, we do. We have more than 400.
Before the war began?
Yes.
But you're reporting to me that you have had none at all?
In the last 24 hours.
And the Egyptians are the ones who are reporting about these 50 tanks.
No, I would consider it the northern area. It came from the northern area commander.
Is it true?
No, it's just rumors came in the media, but it's not happened through my chain of command.
So you have received absolutely no Iraqi soldiers in the last 24 hours?
No.
What is the situation with your land troops? Are they involved in any activity?
Well, I cannot comment on that. Now we are, we started this air power attack to free Kuwait based on the United Nations resolutions. And I will leave it to that, and the future will show what's going to happen.
We know the Saudis and the Saudis and the Kuwaitis took part in the air raid, is that correct, with the Arab forces?
The Saudis and the Kuwaitis, not only they took part, they took a good portion of that air raid.
Were there any Arab forces involved in the air raid?
No, only Saudis, Kuwaitis, French, British, and of course big support of our friends, United States Air Force.
Were the Arab planes deployed to Iraq or Kuwait or both or what?
You mean the planes?
Yeah.
Well, I don't like to go into that details. I will leave it to the Air Force through their announcements.
General Khalid bin Sultan, the commander of the Joint Arab Forces. Our coverage of the Gulf War continues in a moment. We'll have a guest to talk to us about the psyche of Saddam Hussein. Stay with us.
CNN's Wolf Blitzer has been keeping his finger on the pulse of the Pentagon today, and apparently he has some new information for us. Wolf?
Well, we just had a briefing over here with your Defense Department official who provided additional details of Operation Desert Storm. First of all, there is now confirmation that U.S. aircraft and bombers are going to resist some of the targets that were bombed on day one. So the success rate earlier today we learned was 80%. 80%, approximately 1,200 so far have already been conducted or missions. And it seems that that number will probably go up to about 1,500 before the 24-hour period of day one is complete. But clearly the U.S. Air Force and Navy want to take a look at some of the initial targets, make sure they were completely destroyed, and they're going to be going back probably even as we speak right now. And those targets, also told, are throughout Iraq and occupied Kuwait, including in Baghdad. There will be another bombing run through Baghdad, through strategic targets that the U.S. and the Allies have determined are very, very important, and that is undergoing, that's probably started sometime back. Pentagon official who asked not to be identified says that we also expect of Turkey to be making some sort of announcement later today, very, very soon, offering some of the U.S. Aircraft at a base in Turkey to go ahead and participate in these airstrikes against Iraq. So far, there is still no confirmation that any of Iraq's Scud ballistic missiles have been launched. There is a sense here at the Pentagon that all of the fixed-site Scud ballistic missiles have backed out. There are though still concerned that some of the Iraqi mobile Scud missiles may have been moved, may have been hidden, and still represents a source of some concern to senior Pentagon officials. There is some concern that the Iraqis may yet manage to launch a Scud missile, although that has not yet occurred. The word here, the official word is only one U.S. fighter aircraft was down with A-18, a Navy plane, and the pilot was killed in that operation over Iraq. There's also word that there were still 100 Tomahawk cruise unmanned missiles that were launched against targets. No confirmation that any additional Tomahawks have been launched. We did learn from this senior Pentagon official that U.S. ground forces are moving closer to the border, but they have not moved across the border into occupied Kuwait. The airstrikes are going to continue at least for the next few days. Also, this sense from the official that there does not yet appear to be any greater resistance, anti-aircraft resistance from Iraqi forces as the hours of this war continue. The general sense as a matter of policy or just as a matter of tactics is that ferocious anti-aircraft resistance probably occurs at the start of an air campaign rather than it continues. We did get confirmation also from senior Pentagon official that the U.S. B-52 long-range strategic bombers are involved very, very significantly in this campaign. Earlier, CNN reported that the B-52s were using some of their very heavy bombs to go after elite Republic Guard forces in northwestern Kuwait and Iraq. There's also a final word here from this briefing that Pentagon reporters had that some of the U.S. and allied planes that went over Kuwait and Iraq didn't drop bombs, but actually dropped leaflets in Arabic explaining to the Iraqi troops and others exactly what was going on with themselves. Joining me in our Washington bureau to discuss some of these issues is CNN special assignment correspondent Stephen Emerson, who himself is a recognized authority on terrorism and other issues. He's been checking with his sources here in Washington. Steve, what, first of all, can you tell us about the threat of terrorism emerging from this war?
Well, that obviously is the ace in the hole in Saddam Hussein's arsenal. At this point in the United States, the FBI has basically been working together with parts of the military, and they don't really believe that there's really any hardcore threat to American installations, bases, or centers in Washington or any other metropolitan area. That's different, however, for Europe. And I think in the next 3 or 4 days, we'll probably see some outbreak of freelance terrorist groups striking on behalf of Saddam Hussein, if not directly controlled by him, certainly done in the spirit of sort of punishing the American infidels who have attacked the Arab land.
Steve, you've checked with your sources. How do you see this operation going? What's the next stage, in your opinion? Is it going to be strictly air? When will the ground troops go in?
It's a good question. The phase one has already been basically accomplished, softening up the targets, hitting out the anti-aircraft missiles, and hitting the offensive capability of Saddam Hussein to retaliate. Phase two will be going after and demolishing Saddam Hussein's weapons of mass destruction. Obviously, to hit and destroy a nuclear site or a chemical weapons facility that's built perhaps 6 stories underground, it takes more than just 2 or 3 airstrikes. It could take perhaps a dozen. And I think that's what's going to happen right now. The third phase of the campaign, which could start in 4 days, 5 days, will be the ground onslaught. And that really will be the test of the United States to wage the most precarious and probably the most dangerous part of this campaign, where there will be hand-to-hand combat with Iraqi soldiers in Kuwait if they do not surrender or leave.
Well, do you think that Saddam Hussein is going to surrender? What are your intelligence sources telling you about that?
I spoke to Israeli intelligence people who do not believe that Saddam Hussein will ever formally surrender. In fact, they believe that he has nothing to gain by surrendering. He could still lose the war, even get demolished, have his weapons of mass destruction destroyed, and still be able to claim he is the victor by having his regime remain intact and say that he stood up to the American onslaught. That is the great fear, however, in a lot of intelligence circles, that we could be in for a long, prolonged stay and a war of attrition that the Israelis saw when they invaded Lebanon in 1982.
Stephen Emerson, thank you very much for joining us. One additional word here from the Pentagon. Yeah, we're told earlier that there will be two briefings scheduled for tomorrow. 1 o'clock Eastern Time with General Norman Schwarzkopf, the commander of Operation Desert Sword, will be a brief. It's now scheduled to take place in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Later tomorrow, there will be a briefing here at the Pentagon about 3:30 Eastern Time with General Tom Kelley, who's been very much involved in all of the planning of this operation. Pentagon officials caution that this war is by means over. It continues, even though they're really pleased by day one. Wolf Blitzer, CNN Live at the Pentagon.
Thank you, Wolf. We'll continue to monitor the events at the Pentagon, and we'll continue with more of the story right after this. Just a moment, Sharyl will be talking with the psychiatrist about Saddam Hussein the man. But what appears to be preparations for an amphibious assault on Kuwait may be underway by Allied naval forces in the Gulf. A WTN camera team, as it flew over the Gulf, obtained these aerials of Navy supply vessels carrying land battle gear, military trucks in desert camouflage, and land battle gear. This was shot today in the Gulf.
What moves a man like Saddam Hussein, psychologically speaking? A lot of experts have given their best educated guesses at that. We're going to talk to one of them now in Washington, Dr. Gerald Post. He is professor of psychiatry, political psychology, and international affairs at George Washington University. He has done a political profile of Saddam Hussein that he presented to the House Armed Services and Foreign Affairs Committees during their Gulf hearings. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
Dr. Post, let me ask you to guess or to anticipate what Saddam Hussein, what his reaction would likely be to hearing that he has been outdone in the air already in these early days, to hearing the optimistic reports by the United States. Is he likely to get more dangerous, depressed, excited, motivated? What do you think?
He expected to absorb a massive defeat in the major airstrike. When Saddam concluded that he could not withdraw from Kuwait without being dishonored and decided to enter conflict, he fixed on something that is a very strong part of his understanding of the American psyche, namely our supposed Vietnam complex. His belief was that if he could survive the air onslaught, he could engage the United States during the phase in a war of attrition, and that he has demonstrated that Iraq is able to absorb many casualties, whereas the forces of the United States, he believed, would not. It is indeed the case, in our mind, that one can win by standing up against a superior opponent. Sadat did this in 1973. He lost significantly, but it enhanced his stature. Nasser in 1967, when Gaddafi's jets were shot down, he thanked the United States for making him a hero. So it is Saddam's belief that he can gain in stature, be a hero to the Arab world by standing up to the United States and surviving this.
And yet it's hard to look at this man and think that he would be comfortable being a loser but a martyr and a hero to his own people. Is he comfortable only when he is victor?
This man is not a martyr, but what I'm indicating is that one can be a victor politically without being a victor militarily. And this man is tough, make no mistake about it, and he will not yield. Whether he will be able to hold the military under its control is another story, but he is quite willing to put the Iraqi people, the Iraqi military, through great hardship to sustain his grand notion of himself as a messianic leader of the Arab world.
Some words that people use to describe the demeanors of Presidents Bush and Hussein in the last couple of days before the war broke out were resolute, determined, and resigned. Are there similarities you see in the personalities of these two presidents?
Well, I believe both Presidents Bush and President Saddam Hussein, each were indeed resolute and determined. I certainly believe that the similarities stop there. President Saddam Hussein has really dreams of glory, and what has happened now, Kuwait has long since gone off the screen, I believe. He became intoxicated by the approval of the Palestinian people, who saw in him their hope for redemption. They saw him as a hero, and he now has really engaged this self-concept as a hero and hopes to go down in Arab history for his courage at this moment in history.
Would you bet that Saddam Hussein has something up his sleeve, or at least thinks he does?
He is very creative. He is very manipulative. I certainly would not be surprised to see the unleashing of international terrorism. One other point to note, his rhetoric is vintage Khomeini in calling President Bush Satan, the criminal, that God is on his side. He is speaking directly to radical Islamic forces, and even those he does not directly control can certainly rise in support of him.
Thank you very much for shedding some light on the personality of Saddam Hussein. Dr. Gerald Post talking to us from Washington. Ralph.
That's it for this hour. There is a lot more coming up. Stay with us for more coverage of the war in the Gulf. For Sharyl Atkinson, I'm Ralph Wenge.
We continue now with our coverage of the war in the Gulf. I'm Donna Kelley.
I'm Lou Waters. Hello. It's 1 a.m. in Iraq, and the bombings continue. A senior Pentagon official tells CNN that Allied forces have launched another round of bombing attacks against targets in Iraq and Kuwait, including another set of missions against Baghdad. In the words of one U.S. commander, this is a 24-hour-a-day war. The casualty figures remain unclear, with the two sides offering conflicting numbers. The Allied forces say they've lost a total of 3 warplanes. The Iraqis say they've shot down 55 Allied aircraft and 23 missiles. Iraqi radio reports 23 Iraqi people killed, 66 injured. CNN's Don Miller has an update on the latest developments.
Allied forces continue to hurl a massive amount of air power against the forces of Iraq's Saddam Hussein. The Pentagon reports at least 1,300 sorties flown against targets softened up cruise missiles. The Defense Department says the attacks have been very effective, but warns this is an ongoing operation. Allied casualties so far, a U.S. Navy FA-18 Hornet shot down, a British Tornado GR-1 fighter bomber, and a Kuwait warplane. CNN's live coverage from Baghdad has been shut down by Iraq's information ministry.
This official, Mr. Allah, who's been a good friend to CNN for our time here, is demanding that we do something that we desperately don't want to do.
Yes, Sir John, I will make the decision to have communications because I'm the senior man here. So for Bob Weiner and John Holloway and John Holloway and Bernie Shore and my old Peter Arnett, who is signing off from Baghdad for CNN, and I hope we can communication with you in the future.
For those of you in Atlanta and up and down the network, we'll get back in touch with you as soon as we can. Obviously, this is something that's just abhorrent to all of us.
Several hours after that happened, a phone call from a resident of occupied Kuwait City provided insights into what has been going on there since the start of Operation Desert Storm.
But at about 9 o'clock, we heard some aircraft noise in the south of Kuwait City, raiding that area near the military hospital. We heard explosions for about 10 minutes, and then it disappeared. And then later, about 11 o'clock, there was a raid on a camp called B1. It's near the city proper, and it's also a huge camp. There was about two explosions, and some aircraft noises were heard.
From official Washington, repeated statements that Iraq's Saddam Hussein brought this battle upon himself, and repeated summations of what he must do to end the fight.
We are going to prevail. I don't want to get caught up in some semantics about all of this. It's got to get out of Kuwait. And got to do it with no concessions or no condition. That was determined long ago when he failed not to comply with the UN resolution. And now, in keeping with those, we are using force. And we're not going to stop until he fully complies with the resolution. So let's not worry about what we call it. Let's worry about calling, if we want to make it clear, full compliance with the UN resolution, full compliance with the objectives of the coalition forces.
Thus far, the Iraqi leader appears unmoved by air raids, much less rhetoric. The Reuters wire service quotes Mr. Hussein's ambassador to Belgium as saying that Iraq still plans to attack Israel. And there was this response when Iraq's envoy to Britain was asked whether the initial success of Operation Desert Storm would make his nation lay down its arms and exit Kuwait.
Not at all. We believe in our cause and we will defend our cause.
News of the initial success of Operation Desert Storm have sent stock prices soaring and the cost of crude oil tumbling. I'm Don Miller, CNN reporting.
For the latest at the Pentagon, we go live to CNN's Wolf Blitzer. Wolf?
Well, a little while ago, we had a briefing with a senior Defense Department official who said that as we speak right now, U.S. fighter bombers are, in his words, revisiting targets in occupied Kuwait and in Iraq, targets that may not have been completely destroyed in the initial wave of U.S. and Allied bombing. Some of the targets are, of course, strategic command and control headquarters, Scud missile bases, nuclear facilities, chemical facilities, all of the day one targets were supposedly very successfully conducted, but to make sure they're sending back the fighter bombers to take some more pictures to assess the situation, to assess the damage. There is a sense, the senior said, that the fixed Scud bases, the Scud ballistic missile bases, were destroyed in that initial run. There is, though, some considerable concern still here at the Pentagon about the mobile Iraqi Scud missiles, whether any of them were hit. There is a fear that perhaps some of those Scuds may yet be launched in the U.S., taking all sorts of precautions to make sure that isn't the case. We do have information that long-range strategic B-52 bombers are upping their bombs on Republican Guard forces in northwestern Kuwait and in southern Iraq. We don't completely know the extent of the damage yet. The U.S. itself is taking pictures, assessing all of the damage from the very heavy bombs. We also know that the U.S. used at least 100 Tomahawk cruise missiles from the battleships Wisconsin and Missouri. Both of them are right now in the Persian Gulf. We do know that U.S. ground forces, army units, marines, are moving close to the border from Saudi Arabia towards... They're on the move, in the words of one senior Pentagon official, but they have not crossed the... yet. They are awaiting additional airstrikes before President Bush and Defense Secretary Cheney and the commanders of Operation Desert Storm send in U.S. ground troops. They want to completely exhaust the air power to make sure once the ground troops go in, they will meet as little resistance as possible. There is no indication here that any Iraqi troops, at least in significant numbers, are surrendering or trying to cross over. The situation remains obviously a source of great concern, although senior Pentagon officials express quiet confidence that day one has gone as good from the U.S. point of view as could have been expected. Yes, Blitzer.
Wolf, I see that one report tells us that pilots are meeting more resistance this time around. Are you getting any new information about that and where the military campaign is right now?
We asked a question to this senior Pentagon official who asked not to be identified by name. Was there more anti-aircraft resistance to U.S. aircraft and allied aircraft? And the answer we got is that the basic answer was that in any air campaign, the stiffest resistance in all of the textbooks, that the stiffest resistance comes at the beginning. War units are destroyed or before command and control headquarters are weakened or radar put out of commission. So there's no confirmation at all that there's stiffer resistance. If anything, the sense is that that is just the opposite.
All right, Wolf Blitzer from the Pentagon. Thanks so much. Lou?
Now, Charles Bierbauer, CNN senior White House correspondent, joins us from the White House. Charles, you just heard Wolf Blitzer report there's quiet confidence at the Pentagon about this initial phase of the war, which we're almost 24 hours into now. What is the assessment by the president?
Well, I think that's a good way of characterizing it. President Bush, at a meeting with congressional leaders today, cautioned against any euphoria at the way things have gone in what are admittedly the early stages of this effort to oust Saddam Hussein and his troops from Kuwait. The president did say, however, that he is very pleased with the way things are going, noted that there is a success with a minimal loss of life. He did say, on the other hand, that there would be no unwarranted optimism. President Bush, when asked about a need for an unconditional surrender by Saddam Hussein, said he wasn't going to get hung up in semantics, but that he is using force and he intends to continue using force until Iraq complies with those UN resolutions. Lou?
Congress seems encouraged. The stock market is through the roof. The casualties, apparently, as far as we know, are low, and yet the president says he's cautioning against this euphoria that you mentioned. Why is that?
Well, for precisely those reasons that it is still early on. Casualties are going to be lower in an air war than they will be in a ground war. As Wolf is indicating, the ground forces are moving towards the Kuwaiti border. If indeed they engage with the Iraqi forces there, inevitably the toll of this effort is going to go up. So you have to be prepared for that. You have to be prepared for the potential of a long siege if those Iraqi troops hold out. All of these things are unknown at this point. So the president is very much, I would assess, on the right track to say let's not get too optimistic too quickly.
What's Iraq's way out of this, Charles?
Well, that's precisely the question I asked the president. Is surrender the only way out? Repeatedly we heard leading up to the deadline and even beyond it that Saddam Hussein could avert a ghastly toll of this war by starting to move his troops out. He can wave a white flag in one form or another, and yet nothing that we have heard from Saddam Hussein in Baghdad suggests that he's ready to do that.
Charles Bierbauer at the White House. We'll be back to you. We will take a break. Our coverage of the war in the Gulf will continue in a moment.